Good afternoon. I'm sorry that we have to sit in here, although the weather is so nice. I also would like to sit outside. So, what do we want to do? So, I would like to give you, first after the introduction, I also want to, or maybe earlier, I want to tell you in what sense my lecture relates to the data challenge you will get tomorrow. And then I will start with pairwise correlation analysis, like cross-correlation, unitary events, and will also tell you quite a bit about analysis pitfalls, so what you have to consider. And then is a next bigger part, like about higher order correlations, in how you can approach these or extract those from population measures, a method SPADE for detection higher order synchrony and spatiotemporal patterns. However, I will emphasize the higher order synchrony because this is something you may also need for your data challenge. So what is the relation to the data challenge? I just tell you what will happen. And this is kind of a warning that it's better that you listen. So the data challenge will be that you get 6 data sets of massively parallel spike trains. And one of this is real data, and 5 others are simulated. And we will actually tell you the features, what so to say the models contained. We want to make it a bit more simple than the last years, where the challenge was only detect the real data set. And your challenge is that you identify which data set is which. Yeah? We will give you a longer introduction tomorrow that you understand what we are talking about, but I just want to let you know that the challenge requires some of the methods introduced here. Okay, the introduction is, if you consider everyday's life, then you notice that natural behavior is dynamic and fast. And for example, free viewing, what you basically do all the time, yeah, you have one sequence of saccade and fixation within 250 milliseconds. This is a pretty short time where you get input and have to digest this somehow and direct your next saccade. Yeah? So if you think about how much time you have left per computational stage, approximately, you have about less than 20 milliseconds for each stage involved. And for reasonable firing rates, this is then in the order of 1 spike per area. This is not my calculation, this Simon Thorpe did at some point. This leads me to the hypothesis that neurons coordinate their activities on short timescales in dynamic fashion for the computation of all that. So this is also supported a little bit by, or not just a bit, but by some connectivity numbers. This is actually a book from Moshe Abeles, who is sitting in the back. This is a list of, for example, neuronal density. You have about 40,000 neurons in a cubic millimeter of cortex. This is a mixture, cat or monkey, okay. And you have about, this number is quite high, but you have on average about 10 to 20,000 synapses per neuron impinging. Yeah. So I find the most important numbers here, meaning, I think I have a different slide, yeah. So this means that you have a high density of neurons and you have a lot of input per neuron. And what is not said on this slide is that you have about the same number of neurons, that the neurons project to about the same number of other neurons, about. So what you basically have is at every stage a high convergence onto an individual neuron and a high divergence to other neurons. And this, I find this is one of the arguments for network processing. That not the individual neuron is, so to say, playing the most role, but neurons together. Now, there are people also, and I just took this figure from Ken Harris because I liked the figure, but there were people much earlier who thought about cell assemblies and how neurons could coordinate in order to process information. And this was actually Hepp in 1949, who first proposed this idea of cell assemblies. And this is being done by interactions of neurons. And for example, cross-neuron correlations are indicators of such assembly membership. So if you think about it, you have, so to say, sensory input eliciting in a subnetwork some spiking activity which propagates to yet another subnetwork and yet to another. And think about for a moment, if you want to detect this, you could, if I take it directly, then if I were able to record from the neurons involved, then I would, for example, have synchronous activity in the first group or almost synchronous, and in the next, and in the next. And when the same assembly is activated again and again, or meaning the same behavior is requested, the assumption is that the same assembly is activated, and then you would have repeatedly this kind of activity. Now, is this what we actually expect to see all the time? Well, as I said already, here you should have caught and recorded all these neurons which are involved. But likely is that we maybe subsample, that we may have maybe one neuron recorded in each of these groups. Then you would see a spatiotemporal pattern, a spike firing with some other neuron with a given time interval bill after it, then another and yet another, yeah? Or if you have only locally your electrodes, you may see only the synchronous activity whenever this group is active, or that. But these are subsampling issues. Now, what would I then expect? How would I imagine that this looks like? That we have, for example, a number of neurons recorded as a function of time. You need to observe the neurons in parallel. Otherwise, you wouldn't see this correlation. We can discuss about that later on, why this is necessary. And then you could imagine that, for example, when a particular cell assembly is activated, that a subset of the neurons you observe is firing synchronously. I'm talking about millisecond precision. Or in for another behavioral request, another set of neurons is activated. But you could easily also imagine that something like this happens, that an individual neuron is participating at different instances in time in different assemblies. Yeah? You have, so to say, the time space as an additional space. Singer called this multiplexing. But this can easily be imagined. Yeah? And so what we want to do is to identify correlated spiking in multiple channel data. And what I started to do many years ago is to develop statistical methods to be able to do this, to analyze experimental data and see in how far the relevance of this network interaction is in relation to the function. otherwise it's kind of useless. This speaks already for looking at recordings from awake animals, which have which behave, yeah, where you can relate it to. So there was a time where the debate was much more intense, and it was hard to survive in this field because people so much like firing rates because they are much more obvious. And there was one seminal work which I like to cite in this context. This was by Meinen and Sajnowski, 95, where the question was always, are neurons precise enough? Would they support fine temporal precision? And what Meinen and Sajnowski did in a dish was to record intracellularly from a neuron upon current injection, a constant current injection here in this case, and they repeated this experiment several times. And you see here the spiking activity from the first, the second, the third, and so on trial. And what you see is that the first spikes are aligned, but then the actual spiking activity diverges quite strongly. However, when they inserted a frozen current into the cell and recorded then the spiking activity, this is the overlaid picture of the 25 trials. And here is the extraction onto the dot display. You see that the spikes occur very much at the very same time. Nowadays, if you are involved in modeling and so on, this is kind of trivial, but at that time, this was, ha, this is an argument. Here you see that neurons can be very precise, yeah? So what makes a neuron fire? This was also a long debate, and I only put part of the work onto this. So, for example, Moshe, sitting in the back, had a paper in 82, and he was asking integrator or coincidence detector. So would an individual neuron integrate in time the input? Yeah, so that the time constant is rather long to be able to add all this up? Or is it a detector which is responding preferably onto coincident or synchronous input? So, and basically what you require, what you require to make neurons fire is that you need to reach a threshold. Yeah. However, the threshold in cortex is about, on average, about 30 to 40 times above the amplitude of an individual EPSP. Yeah. And now you can consider issues like, if all these neurons would fire independently with a certain rate, what is the probability that I have coincident firing of this incoming spikes to make it fire? However, if they arrive synchronously within a certain time window, few milliseconds, then the EPSPs can directly add up and cross threshold. This is a fact. This is accepted in the meantime by everybody. At that time, it was still a big question whether this is true or not. But everybody agrees that a neuron prefers or preferably elicits a spike upon synchronous input. How may this be used in the system? And how can we detect this? Yeah, that there is a correlation between two neurons, so that when one neuron is firing, the other one preferably fires as well, in a or both synchronously. And there was in 1967, George Gerstein and his group developed, besides the PSDH, developed also the cross-correlogram, or brought it into neuroscience. Actually, he was a physicist, as many of the computational neuroscientists, and knew this from physics and brought it into the neurosciences. And I just want to give you an idea what this does. So you have two spike trains, S1 and S2. You have here spikes and from the other neuron. And what it does, it represents at the end the probability to finding any spike in spike train S2 as a function of the time before or after a spike in train S1. Meaning, what you do is you sit on a reference neuron, which is in this case the upper one, and record, register all the spikes relative to this one. So you register, so to say, the time interval that the spike is occurring here after this and there. These are all these intervals which I registered here, and you enter, so to say, at these points in time, you enter an entry in this histogram. And this is, then you continue like this. You sit on every spike of the reference neuron and register these spikes of the other neuron. And this is then accumulating in this histogram. And at some point, when you bin this, actually a histogram involves binning, you may see, so to say, now a time axis relative to the spiking of the first neuron and when the other neurons fired, before or after. And you may see, for example, such a peak, which may indicate to you that these two neurons tend to fire simultaneously or within a certain time interval. Okay, this is the simple story. Now you can also do this analytically. Typically, you express it as a cross correlation with the delta t with tau. And then you sum this, and you can. There is an analytical description. In case you have parallel Poisson, stationary Poisson, you can actually write it down analytically. But beyond that, it becomes immediately difficult. Now, what do people observe with this? Well, you can, for example, this was from Perrache, 2012, in PNAS. He was interested to identify, so to say, whether excitatory inhibitory neurons are correlated to each other. And you can then see different, and he observed different types of cross correlations. For example, you here can see that there was a spike first, and then there was, so to say, a dip. Or here, vice versa. So you see different types of exciting or suppressing, depending on the combination of neurons. Or also a paper which I can recommend to you, which I like very much. This was a paper by Zandt van Kali, and Cohn, 2015 in Neuron. He was interested on cross-area correlation. And what he did, basically, he recorded neurons from V1 and V2, calculated the cross-correlation, and extracted the delay peak in order to see, or in general, the position of the peak. Are they synchronous, or do they have a certain delay? And this is his statistics. So basically, when he recorded neurons both from V1, that he found that there is that they basically are synchronously active. But when he looked at V1, V2, he saw that the neurons in V2 actually fire some milliseconds later. Yeah. So basically, what is a statistic being done here, that this peak is a bit later than zero. This is then the assumed delay between the two neurons. Or other studies, older ones, which I also find quite impressive. This is work by Winrich Freiwald, who recorded two neurons from visual cortex. visual cortex, yes, A17 of CAT in this kind. And what he was interested in is, do we have, so to say, a reflection of gestalt perception in the neuronal activities, in the correlation of the neuronal activities? And what you see here is, so to say, the receptive field of neuron 1, the receptive field of neuron 2. And what he did is he once stimulated this neuron with a common bar and moved this bar across these two receptive fields together. Or in this case, he cut the bar into two and moved onto the top neuron from this side and the other one from the other side. And what you see here is the cross correlations between these two same two neurons, one and two. In this case, in the one bar situation, in this case, the same neurons when they have two different bars moving, and you see that you here have a clear peak, multiple peaks actually, in this cross correlogram. What would this indicate to us? But that there are multiple peaks? Oscillation. So typically you need to make in such, I come back to this, but as you may read it here, when you see this, you may think of that they, in an oscillatory fashion, and also with oscillatory, so to say, also the delays, that they coincidentally fire. So this is why you should also look at the autocorrelation at the same time, that you can observe whether they are actually oscillatory firing or not. But the most interesting part here is, for me, that if these two neurons get this kind of stimulation, they are not correlated. You don't see this anymore. And this is what I typically would call functional correlation, that neurons can, depending on the request or depending on the stimulation, either be correlated or not. And this means that connectivity is not everything, because we are talking the two same neurons, but just in different context given the sensory input. A similar picture is here, which is maybe not so super intuitive, but this is two simultaneously recorded neurons in CA1 when Red was performing an auditory or visual discrimination task, the very same neurons. And these two neurons exhibit a clear central peak for the visual task, but if you present them an auditory task, they are not correlated. And the interpretation of Sakurai was that in the interpretation that these two neurons belong to a cell assembly that enables visual discrimination. So this is the line of thought that you see the argument. Now, something what you also want to know, this is what, I forgot your name, Noam, what Noam just said. Now, if you want to know whether there are coincidences or synchronous events, are they beyond what I would get by just the firing rate? Why is this of interest? Please. Yes, it could be one neuron is firing oscillatory, the other one not, and suddenly you see a modulation in your cross correlation, and you want to know, does this indicate interaction between these neurons, or is this because this is just their base firing rate? Yeah, this is typically what we want to know. And I cheated a little bit that you probably saw here that there were some lines in here and so on. These are different types of predictors. However, this was in early times, and they were maybe a bit too simple. So what I want to show you is that what we want to do is to compare the empirical cross-correlation to the cross-correlation predicted by the firing rates. And my conclusion from over the years working with this kind of, with real data, which are typically non-stationary and inhomogeneous across trials and maybe even deviate from Poisson, that you, that so to say, classical predictors analytically do not work at all. You cannot capture all these features in your predictor, that many of the surrogate, many of the predictors and kind of bootstrap methods also violated some of the assumptions. So I want to show you what you can do and what you can do wrong as well. So, and I show this to you on the example of the cross-correlation, but this holds for all the upcoming analysis as well. So this is what I just said. Your neurons typically fire, and you put a lot of effort into it to make them change their firing rate, right? You want to respond them to a stimulus and so on. So the firing rates change over time. But also there is often, so to say, a DC change across the trials, which may be modulated by changing attention level or so. They are often they often deviate from Poisson, at least in the data I mostly work with. Motor cortex, they are more like gamma processes, but there are also other ways. And you often have a latency variability when the neuron is responding, and if you then want to make statistics across trials, you need to deal with this as well. Yeah, this is then a non-stationarity across trials. So here you see an example of a real data set. I took this figure from a paper, it could be any paper, from Wadia. So what you see here is time in a trial. You see it across trials, one neuron across trials. And I would like to tell that you tell me what you see in this dot display. Yes, so you see here, yeah, this, whatever you can call a latency onset, but you see that this change is quite considerable across trials. This is mostly, yeah. And is it okay then to make such a PSDH? What does this chain tell me here? Uh-huh. Yes, you have, so to say, a non-homogeneous data set. And your conclusion that the firing rate is changing slowly is not true for the individual trial. And because you have to do, because you have to do your correlation analysis on a trial-by-trial manner, two neurons, one trial, two neurons, one trial, two neurons, the other trial, you need to consider this aspect. Otherwise, you get false positives. So, and I think you have also some exercises contained in this. These are, so to say, just illustrations again. For simulated data, so in this case, these are simply Poisson processes across different trials, and the firing rate profile we used was, I think, 20 hertz, and then it jumped on to 100, and then it went back. And I would strongly suggest that when you, even when you do a correlation analysis, that you still look at these aspects of the data. Don't do a sophisticated analysis directly on your data. You need to get a feeling for your data. You need to know what they are doing. Yeah. So here, for example, what is illustrated here, the PSDH, the dot display, and here you see a rough, as for a rough estimate, the spike counts across trials. What do I want to learn from this? Yeah? So what do you say to this example? And why? In here? How do you see this? You may see, that's true. You see here that there are this stripy, is this stripy appearance? So the underlying algorithm to generate this data was that in some trials, and randomly, so to say, in some trials they jumped up to 150 hertz, and in some only to 50 or something like this. But on average, you again have 100 hertz in the PSDH. So if you immediately, for example, do the PSDH, you would have a wrong conclusion. And here you see that these spike counts are much more variable. This is at least, you could, so this you could still for Poisson processes and so on, you could still calculate what variability you would expect here. Yeah, even if it's so mixed, but it's a rough indication. And what's going on here? Excuse me? Yeah, this is the Wadia example we saw before, yeah, that they change at different points in time, which appears as a ramping firing rate, and the variability is also larger than for this. And typically you should also, I didn't show this here, but you should also look at the inter-spike interval distribution at the same time. Are they Poisson or is there something else weird? This is important that you know that. Yeah, here it comes related to this. I just want to train a bit your eye. So what do you see here in this dot displays and how far do they deviate? Although their PSDHs are very much alike. What you see, not reading the title, this doesn't help. What else? Here in this case it's more the offset, right? You see that the increase of the firing rate is kind of, you even see it systematically here because we aligned it like this, but this, when you estimate the firing rate by a PSDH as we did it here and use then this for all the trials, you miss this change in the offset in time. Yeah, but that's true. But this is, so to say, also a function of the firing rate, as it is here. Here the intervals are also denser than here, although...
I mean, if I would take all the ISIs together, yeah, in the
Or in other words, if you calculate the ISI distribution of a process which has a changing firing rate, you get a strange mixture, and you should be aware of that. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, yeah, this is how I see them, because I see these little snakes. But this is, I think, a mere visual impression. You can try, yeah. But it depends. It depends what you want to do, yeah. So this is only looking at individual spike trains, and it depends on the method you want to continue with, what you want to do with your data, yeah. Whether you want to take this effort. Good. Mm? So what I want to say is that an analytical description of the cross correlation, I mean of the predictor for the cross correlation, that includes all these features is basically not doable. Even much smarter people than I try to do this, and who are analytically much more capable as I, and they, Carl van Vreeswijk or others, this is basically very difficult. I just tell you, yeah. So, and why I tell you this is, of course, you would like to have an analytical description because it's much faster than what I tell you now, yeah. So, what we then at some point started to do, and this I actually learned in a on a conference which was actually mostly on EEG, and there I heard the first time the word surrogate. And surrogate is an expression for an artificial data set, however generated from your original data set. Yeah? And what people did early on already are things like trial shuffling, you may have heard, yeah? That you want to look at correlation from the empirical data, trial by trial, you correlate them, and then you mix the trial IDs, and then see what is left over when the neurons are actually independent. But as you will see in a moment, this is only of limited use. Or what people also like to do is to randomize the spike trains. Thereby you also destroy the correlation. If you place, you keep the number of spikes, but you place them randomly. You can do a shift of the spike train, yeah, to destroy the correlation. Or you can, as in Ikigaya, he used a very weird surrogate that he exchanged individual spikes across the trials. Or what you can also try to do, but I don't want to emphasize this too much here, is to, so to say, keep the inter-spike interval, the now and next, and then according to a certain probability distribution, displace the spikes. But what we nowadays mostly do, also in more sophisticated methods, is to do the following, that we take from the original spike data each individual spike and dither this a little bit in time. in order to destroy the potential correlations. And I show you the effects of a number of these effects. So, of these methods. So here you have, this is also in my book chapter, in one of the book chapters I have in this book. By the way, I brought a box with books, which I put here that you can have a look at them or use them. So what we wanted to show here is that on artificial data, which we have completely under control, yeah, that the important thing is to know the ground truth. Yeah, what is in the data? If you use experimental data, you don't know what features they actually have. You can just try to extract them, but you cannot say, yes, this is correct or it's not correct. So what we did here is to simulate two neurons with a given firing rate change as a function of time. They do this coherently to a certain degree. What do you conclude from this here? What else features do they may have? I can tell you we did put in whatever we knew can make false positives, okay? So we made them homogeneous across trials. They are obviously not Poisson, but have a preferred interspike interval. They have a trial by trial spike count correlation, which is also a strong generator of false positives. So this is what was our data set, and we analyzed this with different kind of our surrogates. And I want to illustrate to you by this how you can try to consider, so to say, the features as best as possible. So in black, you see the original simulated data. And when we had written a paper on these surrogates, and then the reviewers said, well, you need to illustrate on real data that this works. And I thought, how should I illustrate this on real data if I don't know the ground truth? But then I had a great idea. I took two data from two neurons from a data repository from which I knew they are independent. One was recorded on the one day and the next on the other day. And then you can, so to say, also look at the cross correlogram and look, for example, at coincidence counts, trial by trial or so. And then you can illustrate that depending on, here we tested more of these surrogates. So this was the real count. This was the empirical count. That for some surrogates, you would say this is highly significant. And for some, you would say it is not at all significant. Yeah. So the ground truth was they are not correlated, but some of the analysis resulted in highly significant. So now you know all the pitfalls, and keep them a little bit in the back of your head, because this is, so to say, all the time coming up when you will analyze data in the tutorial, in the exercises that you need to learn to account for this properly. So this is an intermediate discussion. Cross correlation is a standard tool that allows to observe synchronized or delayed spike correlation. Even if neurons fire independently from each other, we find delayed coincidences. They occur by chance. Differentiate chance correlation from excess correlation to distinguish neuronal processing schemes. For example, by comparison to independent data, calculating a predictor. And we learned about factors that influence the correlation. No, you didn't see it yet, this comes later. And there are extensions now of the cross-correlogram possible to observe the temporal modulation of correlation. This is our next goal, so to say. The point is, for a cross-correlation, you need quite a big piece of data beyond the extent of your cross-correlation. Yeah? This prevents you, in some sense, from following the correlation over a function of time, the dynamics of the correlation. And there were other extents made. And I want to mainly talk about this, but I wanted to at least mention the joint PSTH by Erzen et al. 1989, which is, so to say, in a way, you observe the trial-by-trial cross-correlation in a matrix, and where you can observe along the diagonal at least the modulation of the peak, and can maybe see that there are also are sidebands. But I wanted, this is what I did in my doctoral thesis, I wanted to go actually beyond pairs of neurons, which partly succeeded. So I wanted to tell you about the unitary event analysis, which is for uncovering time-dependent changes of correlation. So as I said, this method is actually was originally developed to observe, to analyze more than two neurons at a time. And what you basically do is you represent your spike trains as sequences of zeros and ones. And then you look for each point in time, for each bin, what kind of composition you have as a vector, and ask yourself, is this pattern, the synchrony pattern, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, is this occurring above chance or not? And as we learned before, we can actually calculate the predictor, derive the distribution, and then estimate a p-value, or we convert it typically to the surprise. This was a bit quick. So what we do is to count the empirical number of coincidences across the trials in a certain window, which we slide along the data. And the null hypothesis is you can try, or you in a first approach, you can use, so to say, the assumption of Poisson processes. You take the firing rate of the neurons within this window and calculate the product of the contribution to get a spike or a non-spike. This gives you then the expected probability. And what you then can do in order to account for the cross trial non-stationarity, you can, so to say, calculate per trial this expected probability. So you estimate from trial by trial the spike counts, and you multiply this correspondingly and get the expected probability and can sum this up across the trials. Thereby, you correct for the cross-trial non-stationarity. And how does it go on? And then you can calculate, so to say, from your mean expected number of coincidences, assuming a Poisson distribution. But we have also other ways generating this distribution, and compare the empirical count and get a p-value. And typically, because p-values are typically good when they are low, we transfer it into a surprise measure by this, so that you have then a high surprise if you have a high, basically a low p-value, or a negative surprise when you have anticorrelated data. Yeah, exactly. Both can happen. I'm not sure if I exactly understood your question. Yeah, so the sensitivity, yeah, we played around with this, if you sort of say whether you should ignore the neurons which do not contribute with a spike, because the more, in this null hypothesis, the more you include which do not contribute, as the less you approximate a Poisson distribution. Yeah, this is one thing. And this is why I also would prefer to use surrogates also here to generate the distribution, that I get away from this, all these assumptions. And in addition, I learned that it's probably not so good to use unitary events for many neurons, because it becomes very, it's very sensitive and yeah. No, I don't, but we can discuss. I would like to discuss about this if you have an idea here. Yeah. No, we didn't. Where are we in time? When did I start? Okay. Need to drink something. So what do we define as unitary events, just to get a bit used to the, also to the way we visualize this? If we have, so to say, three neurons, this is again a simulation. If you have three neurons recorded simultaneously, the analysis unfolds to the individual trials, and you look for a particular constellation across the neurons. You count these events. If, let's assume, if you don't do a sliding window, then you count all the coincident events here, the triplets, and then you ask yourself, is the empirical count larger, significantly larger than the expected? And then we circle, so to say, these spikes which are involved in such an event. We will see in a second why this may be helpful. We do this in a sliding window analysis of 100. Approximately 100 milliseconds, and then treat these individual pieces together. This I skip for now. And then here is, for example, one result, one of the early results we got, but we found this again and again. So here you see, this is a study I did together with Alexa Riele, Markus Diesmann and Art Erzen. So what we did here, these are now real data. These are two neurons recorded in motor cortex in a monkey doing a task where the monkey gets a signal here. And then randomly he may have a go signal here or here or here or here. And I pulled here the trials which were of the maximal length of the waiting time. So I only took these trials. And now you see here the part of the result of the unitary events. First of all, you see here in dark blue, you see the expected number of coincidences as a function of time. This is the result of the sliding window analysis. At the same time, we also calculate per window, we actually count the number of coincidences, yeah, which is the light blue one. And you see already by eye that they deviate quite strongly from each other at certain points in time. And it turned out, if you then evaluate, make this significance analysis, you realize that at certain points in time, it becomes highly significant. And if you project it back onto the original data, these squares mark the spikes involved in excess synchrony. Yes, here is no excess, and we don't know why. But what I want to say is, here you have this classical example I was behind, so to say the excess synchrony varies strongly as a function of time. It's not constant. It is related to behavior when the monkey expects the go signal. Yeah, we thought of a number of we also thought about whether this there is some rhythmicity that the monkey is kind of counting with his leg, because this is so regular, or other events, and this is why Alexa did then another experiment. Yeah? It's not the case. Yeah, so what she did then. She retrained the monkey at some point, and he had only one point in the trial. Actually, originally here at 600 milliseconds, he could have gotten his go signal, or here. And then after that time, when she recorded that, she started to retrain the monkey for 900 milliseconds and this time. And these are is in an early period when he was able to generate the new behavior and did not make so much mistakes, and this is in a later case. Yeah, but what you see is when the monkey knew to make the new task, the occurrence of the unitary events were still at the former time, at 600 milliseconds, and after some training, it occurred at 900 milliseconds. So this was for me a sign, yes, they can also be relearned. It's not just counting. Yeah, that's for me a very strong argument that this is not chance or so. These are basically summaries how you should do a unitary event computation. I think you heard this now, and this is a reminder of what were these various violations which we need to consider. So this is now a short summary of what we found in data with unitary events. In motor cortex, we found that unitary events occur at behaviorally relevant points in time. When the timing of the task changed, the occurrence time of the unitary events changed as well. And unitary events look stronger to the face of the LFP than the chance coincidences. In visual cortex, this I didn't show, but we also applied it to visual cortex data during free viewing. Unitary events occur at the begin of rate increase in V1. First spikes after fixation onset lock to the LFP modulation there as well, beta. And this beta oscillation is related to saccade onset. And these spikes, which synchronize, which are locked to the LFP beta oscillation, are synchronized and exhibit then unitary events. Okay, so now a lot of these things you find in this book, which I brought also. By the way, this I wanted to tell you. So this book was originally printed as hardcover and cost an enormous amount of money, which I couldn't fix. But what they did now, 2-3 years ago, because this book has a very, people use it a lot. You can either get it as an e-book if your affiliation has a corresponding contract with Springer, or you can get a copy of this book for 25 euros. This is called My Copy. Again, if your institution has this Springer abo. I have it also with me. Unfortunately, this is a soft cover. This is not in color, but it's cheap. Okay, I thought I add for the last quarter of an hour a first approach to massively parallel spike trains and what you can do with what we did up to now. Which was also quite interesting, and then you can maybe also start playing then in your exercises and go beyond pairwise. So, just that you get a feeling, maybe some of you anyway have such data. So these are data which Alexa Riley recorded with a Utah array, because I asked her at some point, couldn't you record more neurons than just 5 or so? But I must admit I was super naive because I did not know what what is coming in terms of statistical analysis you have to deal with. So this is just basically a movie of several trials. What you see here is the dot display now of different neurons, about 100. You see individual spiking. What you see here is when the monkey is moving his arm to the object and back. This is trial start. This is the go signal. And basically what you see is also this data have all these ugly features we saw before, that the neurons, that across the neurons, they are also extremely inhomogeneous in terms of the firing rates, in terms of the coefficient of variation, meaning the regularity. Here, this is basically a population histogram where you see that the most dominant, what you see is that the firing rates change due to the movement. And this is more or less, I wanted to give you an idea how such data look like. And one of the data sets you are dealing with for the data challenge also, the real data also look like this. Now, we started to look into such massively parallel data already earlier. We got data from, I forget his name, from Utah. He recorded multi-unit activity. No, actually, he recorded single-unit activities with a Utah array in visual cortex of cat. However, this cat was anesthetized, and at that time, you see, this was the paper was from 2007. So we began about 2005 to think about this data, and we were kind of overwhelmed because we had 280 single units. I thought, gosh, what do I do with this? And then I said, first, let's merge the spike trends back to multi-unit activity. This is for now enough. These were then about 80 or 85. And what we did as a first step was to pairwise correlate these data with cross-correlation. So you see here a cross-correlation of two of these channels, I must say. And what we did is we compared this cross-correlation to surrogates, rather wide surrogates, and extracted, considered these two positions as correlated when they exceeded 2 or 3 standard deviations of the surrogate, and when the peak was relatively close to 0. So we went through all the pairs, calculated the cross correlations and then knew these pairs were correlated or not. And what we then did as a next step is we said, let's merge this. There were many, many, many pairs correlated, and we thought how to continue with this mess of data. And what we then did is we considered cliques and started a clique is, so to say, if neurons I consider, for example, 3, were all to all correlated, so pairwise correlated. So we formed cliques which had at least 3 multi-unit activities involved, and they went up to cliques of about 7 or 8. So there were groups of neurons which were composed of 7 spike trains, where all were pairwise mutually correlated, which I found already amazing. But this was still too much too messy, and what we then did is we formed, so to say, cluster of cliques, and the requirement was that the cliques overlap by at least 1 multi-unit activity. And the result of this you see now here. So you see here, these were the IDs of the electrodes, and you see each line indicates a significant correlation according to the definition I gave before. And interestingly, when you now cluster these, you realize that immediately we found 4 groups of intercorrelated cliques. So this was a highly intercorrelated set of multi-units, this one, and this one. And these individual ones here were correlations which were also significant, so above chance, but were not involved in cliques. I was very surprised about this and found this interesting, and wanted then to know how this maps onto the cortex. This is now a, so to say, activity correlation map, so to say. And we, as you see now, we colored them in red, and these in green, and these in cyan, and these in dark blue, and mapped them back onto the cortex. Oh, this is a terrible figure. Okay, but I think you can recognize. So what you see here now, you see now the Utah array. These are the individual electrodes. And what we marked here is when the activity from this electrode were involved in at least one significant correlation within these clusters. And the larger the radius, the radius indicates in how many significant correlations this data, this multi-unit was involved. So as you can also see from here, you can just count in how many there were involved, in many, yeah. But in addition, what I found even more surprising is that these activity correlations cluster in space, in cortical space. The reds are together, the greens are together, the cyan ones are more or less together, and we have one thingy here and one there, which actually makes sense. If these were, so to say, these areas of common preferred orientation, and there is some distance to the next, so to say, place where there is the same orientation as for that one, and so on. So there is at least an explanation whether why this is also red, why this is involved in this activity cluster. And this grouping I found extremely interesting. I never saw it again afterwards in another kind of cortex. I guess it's related that it was visual cortex and anesthetized cat. And one important thing which you should also know, what we looked then also at the distance dependent probability to find correlated pairs. Distance dependent probability to find correlated pairs, because we can calculate on the on the Utah array the different distances of the recordings and say, for this distance relatively close, there is a high probability that they are correlated, then it decayed, but then it came up again, which also speaks in a way for this correlated orientation domains, so to say. Okay, so I summarize now this last part and then gave a general summary. So what we did is we detected pairwise correlation by cross-correlation. The significance was evaluated by dithering. Many pairs were significantly correlated. We formed cliques and clusters of cliques. Four distant clusters of correlated activity appear, and these clusters also cluster in cortical space. And the interpretation was very much in line to what people found on orientation domains like Kenneth et al. Or Zodix et al., where they found things like that, so to say, the even during spontaneous activity, that orientation domains were regularly visited. Yeah, this orientation domain and this orientation domain and this one, which could be the reason that we observe these correlations. I can highly recommend these papers. This is the modeling part of it, and these were the experimental data. And in general, fine temporal correlation may be overseen. You just don't see it when you look at the data. You need to use tools, and one standard tool is the cross-correlation histogram. You need to correct for the expectation by the rate to get accessed by synchrony. It enables also to observe delayed correlation, but it requires long data stretches, and it's hard to follow dynamics of correlation. This is why we invented at that time the unitary event analysis. Unitary event is not restricted to pairwise analysis, and a pairwise approach to massively parallel spike trains based on based on pairwise cross correlations and clustering. So I think I stop for today and continue then tomorrow for the last part on higher order correlations, but maybe you can already work into this direction on your exercises, that you can ask me a lot of questions tomorrow as well. Yeah? Thank you very much.